Julián, una tía niña.
Come a day, I know without a doubt, around the throne the saints will bow and lay down every crown. How glorious that moment to see him face to face, to hear him say, "Well done, my child, you finished your race." But for now the sun's still shining, there's work to still be done, as we're waiting for the promise of what is yet to come. Finish well, every day that we are given, finish well. Days to be courageous, bold and full of faith. So wherever he may lead us, whatever it may cost, let the church arise and lift the banner of the cross.
Finish well, every day that we are given.
Till he comes. Amen. That means we're to be working and watching and waiting for the return of the Lord. And listen, be excited about it also. Amen. While we're still down here, it is not a time to quit. It is not a time to lay down. It's not a time to roll over. It's not a time to give up. Listen, it's more of a time now to be on fire for God than we ever have in our entire life. I've been teaching on Wednesday night, the last couple of Wednesday nights that I've taught, that I believe with all my heart according to the Word of God and according to the world and what's taking place, that we are at the beginning of the end, and it is not a time to quit. Amen? I think we need to march forward harder than we ever have until God steps out. Listen, when he calls his children home, that's when we'll be done down here. Amen? And so thank God for the song. Let's all that can and would, if you want to come gather around the altar this morning while the choir is coming down, and let's pray for a few minutes this morning. If you want to pray right where you are, then that's okay with me too, but it's a time of prayer. And beg God's help for us this morning. Father, again today, God, we love you. And Lord, what a privilege, what an honor it is to serve you, Lord, even in these last days. And Lord, I know that people say, well, Brother Mike, you can't prove it's the last days, but they sure can't prove that it's not. And I believe we're closer than ever for the trumpet to sound and for the Lord to step out on the cloud and call his children home. And Father, I thank you. God, we'll get to see you again on the other side and spend eternity there, Lord, with you. And Lord, while we're here, help us, God, that we would finish well on this side. What does that mean, Lord? That means we're to be working, watching, waiting for return, working, winning others to Christ, Lord, while we're down here. And I pray, God, you'd help us and bless us and use us, that, God, in the end, that you would have the victory, Lord, in our life. It's not about success in us. God, it's about how we represent you well, Lord, on this earth down here. Thank you, Lord, for all those that made their way out here today to the house of God. And, Father, we thank you for our visitors today. We thank you, Lord, for our people. Thank you for our choir. Thank you, Lord, already for our Sunday school teachers and, God, those that worked hard to bring the lessons this morning. What a blessing that's been already for the Sunday school opening this morning. What a blessing there. And, Father, today we ask, God, you'd be with us, meet with us, reign with us while we're in this building. God, without you, Lord, this is just brick and walls. Amen. But God, with you, it's a sanctuary. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have spent in this place, God, with you in our hearts. You said, whether it's two or three gathered together in your name, that you would be in the midst. And God, we thank you so much for being in the midst of us this morning. And Father, we pray, God, that throughout this service day, you just continue to touch our hearts, lift us up. May we look to you for leadership and guidance. Help us to preach with the power and the unction of the Holy Ghost of God. Lord, this morning, Lord, let every word be said that needs to be said, and not one word spoken that shouldn't be said in this place today. God, touch churches and pastors, Lord, all over the world today, and give them wisdom of words and give them strength to stand and proclaim the gospel. And Father, if there's one that comes through our doors today that's lost and undone, and Lord, they don't know you as Lord and Master and Savior of their life, I pray, God, something to be said, sung, or done today. Lord, they'd be convicted by the Holy Spirit of God and come to know you before it's eternally too late. For we know not, God, when the hour's going to come, Lord, that you make that call to come home and it'll be too late. So, Father, you help us and use us and bless us and help the sick today, God, just heal them. Reach out in the hospitals and the homes and touch them and touch some of those that could not be with us today. There's others that's gone to visit dads today and they're having time with them. Would you touch them? Touch those that, Lord, can't see their fathers today, Lord. They may be in a nursing home somewhere. They may be in a hospital facility. And at this time, they can't see them. Some of us have dads that's passed on and gone to glory. God, I thank you, Lord, that my dad's in glory today and I may not see him this day. But I'm thankful there's going to be a day, God, when there's going to be a reunion like none other on the other side. And we'll rejoice throughout the ages, Father. We thank you for that. But, Father, you have your way in the lives of our people today and use us for your glory. We're going to thank you and love you for it all. We ask all these things in Christ's wonderful name. And all God's children said, amen. It is good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. And we appreciate you being here today. It's already been said. Happy Father's Day today to all those fathers that are in here today. We appreciate what God's done in your life. Listen, it ought to be a very proud thing to be a father. And we thank God for you today. We're going to give you the opportunity in just a few minutes to say anything that you would like to say on your behalf. But we thank you for being here today. And thank God for the good crowd that he has sent our way this morning. I pray God just bless you today in a special way. And we want to thank those that came and just supported Miss Duzanne yesterday and her family and the funeral yesterday. We thank God for that and what God did through that. God gave me a brand new thought yesterday to preach at her funeral, just honored her and fit her to a T that I thought. And I thank the Lord for that. Was able to give out the gospel through that. And I want you to pray for us. Jane and I will be flying out on Tuesday, going out to Kansas, and we'll be doing a funeral out there on Wednesday morning at 10 o'clock. And you pray for us. They always had two requests, a couple of requests. Brother Duzanne used to say all the time when he was here, he said, "Brother Mike, I'd give anything in the world if I could send you to Kansas and preach to my people in Kansas." Well, Brother Duzanne died, and guess what? We went to Kansas, and we preached to his people. And Miss Duzanne has been praying for some of her people and some of her grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And she said in this last 6 months, "Brother Mike, boy, we sure wish we could get you out there to preach to our people." Well, guess what? On Wednesday, I'm going to be preaching to their people in Kansas. It may be by a graveside, but I can tell you this. We can share the gospel wherever we go, and we want to be able to do that while we're gone this week. So you pray for Jane and I as we travel, and Steve and Karen as they travel and get back here, and then pray for the traveling mercies going there and back. But don't forget, men, tomorrow night at 6:30 for our men's meeting. We'll just pick that back up again tomorrow night. We've had a great time in our men's meeting. I'm so proud of our men that's been coming and learning and joining in. And so I appreciate that and the men's meeting. So tomorrow night at 6:30, we'll have the men's meeting then. And then don't forget, July the 25th, we have our kids' outreach day from 10 to 1 here at the church. If you know of some kid that I know a lot of churches are not having vacation Bible school this year, we're not either because of the things that are going on. But I do know this, we can still reach out. And so we're going to have 3 hours that day. Most of it will be done outside, Lord willing, if it does not rain. Most of it will be outside that day. But we're going to have devotion time with them, play games with them, eat lunch with them, and just have a good time and try to reach our kids that day. So you come. If you've not signed up yet to help out, we still need your help for that day to come and help out with games and whatever food or whatever that we need for that day. Come and help out with that. If nothing else, come and mentor a child for a couple of hours that day would be good. And just let them hang out with you. Here's what I used to do. For some of you newcomers, I used to do this. And listen, if our bus route and a van route starts back up, chances are I'll do it again. We used to have all those kids coming here on the van. And they come from homes all over this county. And what I would do to those kids from time to time, I'd bring them up front, and I'd get them up front with me, and I'd say, "Look, you look out there, and you choose you a family. And whatever family you choose, that's the one I'm going to sit you with." And I looked at the family and said, "I want you to take care of them and to make sure everything's done for them in church and try to meet their needs and mentor them and some of them families. I know they want to draw up and crawl under the pew sometimes, amen. But that kid would come up, and he'd look out there, and I'm sure they're trying to pick out, you know, maybe the best family, the wealthiest family, that maybe a family with a smile on their face. If you don't want to get one, just be a grouch, amen. But they try to pick out, and they said, "I want that one." I said, "Go over there and sit right between them," amen. And it worked, amen. And so we want to help those kids out that day and get them back in the house of God so that we can preach to them. Listen, we want to see them saved, born again, washed in the blood, and they'll grow up, get their families in church, and it's a way to grow the ministry. And so you pray much about that, if you would, too, okay? All right, any other announcements today? Anything at all? No service tonight. We will not have service tonight. I know a lot of our folks are gone today spending time with their fathers somewhere else, and we respect that. Some of you here spending your time with fathers to here today, and we appreciate that. But no service tonight because of that. But let me do this today. I do have a few birthdays that we want to recognize today. Let me do this before we take the offering today. And so I know there's some young people in here. Where's my kids at today? Where's Rachel at today? Have they left already? They may have had to leave already. But Rachel, who else got? I know Madison. I know you got a birthday. You know they already ratted on you. Come on up. You got a birthday today. Jaden, where's Jaden at? Is Jaden? Yeah, there's Jaden. Ain't he handsome for 12 years old? Amen. Jaden had a birthday. Madison had a birthday. A little. Miss Kathy, come on up here. You fit that group, girl. Come on. Amen. Miss Kathy had a birthday. Amen. Who else had one? Brother Charles have a birthday? Brother Charles, come on up. I said young people, come on. Amen. Amen. Little Rachel, she had to leave evidently, but tomorrow's her birthday, and so we'll have to catch her next week. Amen. But they want to get it. Anybody else have one, or anybody want to rat on anybody at all? I mean, we are Baptists. Y'all can go ahead. It's okay. Amen. We're used to talking about it. I'm just kidding. Amen. But let's all stand and sing happy birthday to them today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Michael, come on up. We'll take an offering this morning. Amen.
All right, we'll get our ushers to come this morning, if they would. And while they're coming, you can be turning. I know we've sung it a lot lately, but that song's just been on my heart. 120, Victory in Jesus. Amen. All the stuff going on this day and time in the world, but every time I think about that song, I think about it. In the end, for the Christians, we win.
Yes.
In the end, we win. So,
amen.
Hey, we'll go to the Lord in prayer and bless our offering. Brother Joy, will you pray for us and bless our offering? Amen. Let's all stand. 120. Victory in Jesus.
Just don't. Okay. All right. All right. It don't either one of them. We'll just say both of them. All right. I'm just trying to get my orders. Amen. And let me just say this today. I appreciate all the fathers in here today. And they're going to sing. They got a couple of songs they're going to do for us here in just a minute. And but I want to make sure to give our fathers opportunity this morning. That if it's something on your heart that you want to share this morning, and thank God real quick for you being a father, and what God's done in your life, or anything you want to share with your family this morning, I'm going to give you that opportunity real quick before they sing. Any father at all this morning got something you want to say? Go ahead, Brother Jeff. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Anybody else, Brother Kyle? Amen. Thank the Lord. Amen. Anybody else today? Any other dad today? Any father? Go ahead, Brother Gene. Amen. 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 I know that. I done jerked him up a couple times. I already got him running scared. Amen. Amen. I love him. Brother Scott. Amen. 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 Thank the Lord. Thank you, Brother Scott. I appreciate that. He is a great father. Brother Tracy. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Anybody else today? Any other dad today, Brother Charles? Amen. Thank you, Brother Charles. Miss Jones done filled up a whole row back there this morning. Amen. So we praise the Lord for that today. Anybody else today? Any other day, Brother Tim? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, Brother Tim. Anybody else, Miss? Amen. Thank you, Miss Teresa. I appreciate that. Amen. Anybody else today? Any other dad today? Or lady, that'd be fine too. Amen. Anybody else? All right. I'm sorry, Miss Jenny. Go ahead. Amen. Praise the Lord. He sure is. Thank the Lord for that. All right. Michael, you and Cam, well, y'all going to sing first and then you and Cam. Amen. They're going to sing up and then they're going to.
I'll just say that I have the best daddy in here, so. And I'm the favorite. Let's just make sure everybody knows. Right, daddy? There you go. Out to hold me when I had a nightmare. You could read quite a story in the calluses and lines. Years of work and worry had left their mark behind. I remember Daddy's hands, how they held my mama tight and patted my back for something done right. There are things that I've forgotten that I loved about that man, but I'll always remember the love in Daddy's hands.
Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands.
I remember Daddy's hands working till they bled. sacrificed unselfishly just to keep us all fed. If I could do things over, I'd live my life again, and I never take for granted the love in Daddy's hands. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in Daddy's hands. There was always love in Daddy's hands.
Well, this next one we're going to do is... Tavis, say something about the next one. And she knew I would get choked up. But I'm thankful for my dad. He's been a great father to me, more than I deserve. I'm thankful for the stand that he's always taken. He's had me in church since I was old enough to get in a little car seat and go. And I'm thankful for it. And I'm thankful for where I'm at today. And there's not a day go by that man didn't pray for me. I know it. But I'm thankful for the call that God put on his life too. Because not only is he my father, but he's also my pastor too. And a lot of people don't know that makes it tough on a family. That's tough on kids a lot of times. Because of the call that man has and the love of God that man has, this church and this church family sometimes comes first because that's his call. That's what God called him to do. And we've had to learn to live with that and love it. It's not a problem. We aggravate him a lot of times about it too, him and mama. And a lot of times it seems like we have to schedule time to be with him. But I wouldn't have it no other way. I love him. And I'm thankful for what he is. I'm thankful for the father that he is. And I'm thankful also that he's a great preacher. Greatest preacher I know of. And I love him. And this next song we're going to do describes my daddy. And I hope we can get through it. Y'all pray for us. Y'all know I'm a big baby a lot of times when it comes to stuff like this. But it describes my dad to a T, I believe. And just talks about, that's my preacher. That's my preacher. We're going to try to get through it if we can. Y'all bear with us. Gets up bright and early to talk to his father. Your burden's still way heavy,
on his mind. He kisses his wife, he grabs a cup of coffee. The hospital call, they say it's just about time. On his way gets a call from a mama with a broken heart. He pulls over and prays for her on the side of the road. No, this won't make the news, will be in the Sunday paper. That's my preacher.
He don't apologize for telling me the truth. He don't water down the gospel just to please a few. He just stands and proudly proclaims Jesus is the only way.
He's no modern day motivational speaker. That's my preacher. He don't punch a time clock. No, he don't get time off. He's on call 24/7, 365. And Washington won't call him and ask for his advice. But every night he has Jesus on the line. He's praying for your babies, your families, and your churches too. He prays God send revival just one more time. No, he's no modern-day motivational speaker, but that's my preacher.
He don't apologize for telling me the truth. He don't water down the gospel just to please a few. He just stands and boldly proclaims Jesus is the only way.
He's no modern day motivational speaker.
That's my preacher. He don't apologize for telling me the truth. He don't water down the gospel just to please a few. He just stands and boldly proclaims Jesus is the only way.
He's no modern day motivational speaker.
That's my preacher.
Preacher, preacher.
That's my preacher.
Set me up with that one. Amen. Boy, God's good, isn't he? I appreciate that. My little buddy's going to come and help Michael sing one this morning. They did this last year. And boy, I loved it. And I appreciate my family. I thank God for them. I really do. There's no doubt they've had to endure the tough end of it. And you think I'm tough on you, you ought to be around my kids. So Brother Mike, your kids are grown and married and gone. I still meddle in their life. I still meddle in their business. Sometimes I think way too much, Brother Ronnie, but if I see them getting off track, I'm a warner. because I love them. Amen. I love this little song right here. Listen to my little buddy up sing.
I am your father.
I'm your son.
When it comes to buddies, buddy, you are the one.
I see me when I look in your face.
I follow you all over the place.
I like to walk.
And I like to run.
But I am your father.
And I'm your son.
I need to teach you
all about life.
You need to learn
what's wrong and what's right.
And you need to learn
it's important to pray.
Go do your math.
Oh, Dad, that's no fun.
But I am your father.
And I'm your son.
There is still so much for you to learn.
That's why God made daddies, so your boys can learn while they grow.
I want to teach you.
I want to learn too.
I want to teach you.
I want to learn too.
I am your father.
And I'm your son.
But months turn to years, and soon my life will be done. But I know you're ready for the struggles to come.
'Cause you are my father.
And you are my son.
Amen. What a blessing. Amen. And I know all them little old seven-year-old girls out there right now are eating their hearts out. Amen. And praise the Lord. Amen. I thank God for my children. And I thank God for the call on our life. And there's no doubt, as I said earlier, my kids have had to deal with a lot over the years. But I'm glad to hear them say they wouldn't change it for the world. And there's no doubt there's been times when they didn't like it and they didn't want to have to endure it. But when God calls us, it just is what it is. But I appreciate them. And I know you appreciate your kids today. And you appreciate what they mean to you and appreciate their love for you today. Man, we ought to love them with all our heart. You know, even when mine mess up, I still love them. I tell them about it, but I still love them. Amen. Around my house is tough. You heard Tabitha bragging a while ago. And I tell people this all the time. I've got 8 girls in my life. Amen. I got a wife, a daughter, 2 daughter-in-laws, and 4 granddaughters. And I have 8 women in my life that I have to please. And it's tough. And every one of them want to be number one. And when your little 5-year-old granddaughter comes to you at church on Sunday morning like this and says, "Pa, you're my treasure." Amen. I know she's going somewhere with that. Amen. And I have to be careful. We was getting out yesterday. It's happening. The girls with us, and we was going out to eat. And Brooklyn jumps out and says, "Pa, you hadn't said anything about my dress." And I said, "I'm sorry, Shug." I said, "It's beautiful. It's beautiful, and it looks great." And Tabitha gets out and said, "Pa, you hadn't said anything about my braces." And I'm said. I mean, Abigail, and I said, "Abigail, they're beautiful. They just look beautiful." And Izzy gets out and just stands there. And I said, Izzy, you're just absolutely beautiful. She runs to the other two. She said, Pa said, I was beautiful. Amen. And so trying to eat supper with that last night's tough, you know, when they're staring in your eye going, did you really tell her that? And then, you know, didn't tell us anything. And so it's tough. But it's a joy to have kids. And how many of y'all just think, all you grandparents, and you just think that's the most joyous thing in the world? Amen. I thank God for it. I wanted to kill mine sometime along the way. Amen. But I wanted to love them grandbabies to death. And I still do. Paige just sent me a picture this morning, little Beckett. This morning, sleep on her shoulders, and I thought, oh, I love him so much, just seeing him. And I thank God for that and what God's done in our family. And I appreciate my family being here at the church. I'm a very privileged pastor to have my family with me and for them to help and support me the way that they do. And I'm sure there's been messages and times they think, Daddy, I'm going to just love you through this one right here, amen? Regardless, I'm going to love you anyway. And so we thank God for that. Amen. Turn your Bible this morning, the book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 8. I don't know how far I'm going to get this morning. It's 11:34 already, but I'm going to try to do the best I can. I did something this morning that I don't normally do. From time to time, I will, because I can't make my mind up, and my mind's torn, my heart's torn sometime on what to do. And especially days like this, Tabitha asked me, yesterday in the vehicle, she said, Daddy, you got your message ready for tomorrow? And I said, I sure pray so. Girl, I've been working on it. She said, you're going to preach a Father's Day message? I said, I don't plan to, but I don't know. Amen. And so this morning I was toying with that and whether to preach a Father's Day message. But I can tell you this, through all that's been said and done and sung this morning, I'm not going to go there with that today. I want to preach something to you that God's laid on my heart some few weeks ago. That I've been studying and looking at and praying over. And I pray that it'll be a help to you. We're in some terrible times right now. We're in some tough days right now. And I think we need to learn some things. And we need to learn what to do and how to do and how to prepare for the days ahead. I think we're going to see tougher days ahead. And I believe that those that fail to remember history will repeat history also. And so if we look in the Word of God, we can draw strength from it and to learn how to make that stand. And so 1 Samuel chapter number 8, I'm going to read all 22 verses here, and then we'll get as far as we can on the message today and see what God does. The Bible says, Israel here in chapter number 8 of 1 Samuel, Israel is demanding a new king. They want new order. Now we understand, I don't know if y'all have seen this or heard this, but the Luciferians are marching today all around America. Matter of fact, they have a march in Raleigh today, I think from 5 until 8 o'clock this afternoon. There will be a big march there, and they're marching in other states today also. Now, I don't know if you've seen it, but it's the Luciferian march, and they are marching for one world order. They want something new. They want change, and they want to be heard, and they want to be the, Brother Ronnie, we talked about that preeminence this morning in the Sunday school class. They want preeminence in the world. Amen. We know that Satan, no doubt, is a prince and power of the air, but we know who's in control. Amen. We know that God Almighty is in control. We know that he is still seated on the throne up in glory, and neither Satan nor the Luciferians, neither the Black Lives Matter group or anybody else will dethrone God. Amen. They may make some changes on this earth that we'll have to be aware of, but they will not ever dethrone God. Amen. God will call us out of here, leave this mess to them, and let them have it and die and go to hell with it, but they won't dethrone God. Amen. And so the Israel is here after they've been a people that has tried to serve God at this time. They were a people that were hearkening unto God in 1 Samuel chapter number 7 and verse 4, verse number 1. You'll find out that God was in the midst of them. God was in their heart at this time. And now they have come to a sad point in their life, such as America, that they want something new. And here they are demanding a new king. This is some 25 years of time that has elapsed from the time They said in 1 Samuel 7 that they were hearkening unto God until now. There's about 25 years that has elapsed at this time. And now in their life, here's what they're saying. We want a new king. They had forgotten who they were. They had forgotten who God was at this time. And they wanted something new. And if you can, thinking about that march today around 5 o'clock, if I was you, I'd find me a private place somewhere and begin to pray. You said, Brother Mike, that's not going to bother me. Let me just tell you this, friend. It's going to affect us somewhere down the road. Amen. We're going to have to make stands like we have never made before. We're going to have to lose friends over it. People are going to have to die because of it in order to get straight back in America again. So you better make it a matter of prayer and realize that it will affect our life, and not only our life, but it affect the lives of our children and those to come down the road. Listen, I am more concerned right now, not because of me. I've lived a great life for 59 years here on this earth, and I thank God for it. I've had freedom all my life, but I am very concerned about the freedom of America for my kids and my grandkids down the road. Amen. Listen, I got news for that crowd out there. They're not willing to die for what they believe in, but there's some of us that are willing to die for what we believe in. Amen. They just want something they think they're entitled to. I want to keep what's already ours. Amen. I don't want to be held captive to the world for the rest of my life. I want to make sure that we can follow God in all that we do. Here in 1 Samuel chapter number 8, start reading verse 1. The Bible says, "And came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel." I did turn myself on. Just want to make sure. "Now the name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second Abiah. They were judges in Beersheba, and his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre and took bribes and perverted judgment." Now, I'm not sure how much talk Samuel had with his sons at this time. I do know that when Eli went through this, he had two sons named Hophni and Phinehas, and you'll find out they didn't do things right in the sight of God, and you'll find out that the lights went out in Israel when that happened. Talking about my kids today, listen, mine will tell you right now that I see them going the wrong way, then it's time to say something. Whether they like it or not, you know, you got to tell them when they're wrong according to the Word of God. It's not about following Mike Witt's rules along the way. It's about what the Word of God says and right for your life. Now, I don't know what Samuel had told his sons right here, but I do know this. I know the people had recognized that his sons were unruly and they were not godly at this time. And Samuel had become an old man. And verse 4 says, "Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah and said unto him, Behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations." Amen. They had forgotten what made them strong to begin with. They were not strong because they were like other nations. They were strong because they were unlike other nations. Amen. Israel was supposed to be a godly people, and it's what made them like they are. Listen, if you want to fall in the weakness, start following the world. Amen. If you want to fall in ungodliness and see God take his hand off of people, take his hand off of a family, or take his hand off of a church, you allow that church to start following the world and the ways of the world and the things of the world, you're going to find an ungodly church real quick, because Satan will get in and weaken it and do everything he can to tear it down. They may still have services on Sunday morning, but there'll be no count for God and the work of God, and make sure that the ministry continues for the Lord. But listen, they wanted a king. They wanted to be like other nations. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to judge us." And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. Listen what the Lord said. This is a sad day right here. I believe that we've got a God sitting up in heaven today that's probably telling us the exact same thing. The Bible says here, "And the Lord said unto Samuel, Hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee. Listen, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them." Amen. Listen, it's not that they're rejecting Samuel here. They're rejecting God. It's not that the people are rejecting me and what I say if I get up here and preach the gospel. The fact is, they are rejecting a holy God. It's not that the people reject where the church stands. They could care less about the church and what it is. They just don't like the idea of the church presenting a holy God in their face. Amen. They don't like that convicting power of the church. They don't like that convicting power of a pastor. They don't like that convicting power of the people. They don't like that convicting power of a church member that's around them. They don't like that, and they don't like it in the world either. But God says, hey, go ahead, Samuel. Hearken to them. Let them do what they're going to do. They're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me. And so many times, if we're not careful, and I can get within myself sometimes and think, man, I thought I was a pretty good guy. And I thought I was doing okay, and I don't understand why they're just so rebellious. But I find out they're not rejecting me. They're just rejecting God. They don't want anything to do with God. You know why? You know what? Listen, you know why your kids are rebellious to you sometime, and my kids are rebellious to us sometime? It wasn't because they're rejecting me. They're rejecting God. They didn't want to follow the ways of God. Amen? They didn't like that convicting power of the Holy Spirit of God over them in life. Verse number 8, it says, according to all the works which they have done since the day that I brought them up out of Egypt, even unto this day, wherewith they have forsaken me and served of the gods, so do they also unto thee. Now therefore hearken unto their voice, howbeit, listen to this, there are protests found in the Bible. Amen. God said, yes, protest solemnly to them. In other words, God's saying here, go and charge them of the matter and go and warn them of what's going to take place if they do. Let them go ahead and do it, but don't just let them do it without telling them the consequences and the price. I've had to look at my kids before, and I've had to look at other people before in the church when you're trying to teach them. And I said, hey, you may go ahead, and I'm going to, if you want to go ahead, you go right ahead and do what you're going to do. But I want to warn you of the consequences that's going to take place if you do that. So God said, hey, go ahead and let them, but protest solemnly unto them. In other words, teach them or charge them what they're doing. And it says here, show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them. And Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that asked of him a king. And he said, this will be the manner of the king that shall reign over you. Listen to this. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself and his chariots and to be his horsemen, and some shall run before his chariots, and he will appoint him captains over thousands and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear his ground or work his ground and to reap his harvest and to make his instruments of war and instruments of his chariots. And he will take your daughters to be confectionaries and to be cooks and to be bakers, and he will take your fields and your vineyards and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants. And he will take the tenth of your seed and of your vineyards and give his officers and to his servants. And he will take your men servants and your maid servants and your goodliest young men and your asses and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your sheep, and ye shall be his servants, and ye shall cry out in that day. Did you understand here how much he's going to take? Do you realize what he's saying here? Samuel said, hey, God has told me to tell you to go ahead and do that if that's what you want to do. But I want to warn you what he's going to take from you. Listen, if I could do anything at all today to warn this church and warn my people and warn my kids today to stay out of the world, quit messing with the world, and leave the world alone and leave this mess alone of wanting something new all the time, because I tell you what's going to happen in the end. They're going to take, and they will never give back anything at all. But the Bible keeps saying here, he's going to take this and he's going to take that. Verse 18 says, and ye shall cry out in that day, and because of your king, which ye shall have chosen you, and the Lord will not hear you in that day. God's going to shut his ears off here to Israel. And there's going to be a day and a time that God's going to shut his ears off to America. There's going to be a day and a time when God's going to shut his ears off to the church. And he goes on to say here in verse number 19, listen to this. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel. And they said, nay, I heard every word you're saying, but we still want a new king. We still want to go that way. The story here reminds me of David, and I'll get into the message here in a minute. It reminds me of the story of David that I worked on sometime on Wednesday night here in our church sometime back, and when David committed adultery, and we know the story there and what David done, and we found out what sin and demons did in the life of David. And here's where we got to be so careful. I'm talking about a man that was after God's own heart. I'm talking about a man that really loved God. And down inside, I believe that his heart was set on just searching God and finding God and doing what was right in the sight of God. But David had a little fault there that he went out when he shouldn't have been. The Bible says in that story about David there in 2 Samuel chapter 11 verses 1 through 5, the Bible says it was a time when kings should have been at battle. But we find out about David at this time that David was at the house, kicked back in his easy chair, doing absolutely nothing, even though he was a man after God's own heart. He was kicked back at the house, watching, doing what he shouldn't have been doing at that time. He should have been on the battlefield. And listen, sin caught his eye at that time. And when sin caught his eye, I preached this on Wednesday night some months ago now, or taught it. We was going through the lesson there. We taught how sin had ensnared his mind. And he couldn't get it off his mind. Once he saw it, once he saw the beauty of it, once he desired it, listen, he could not get it off of his mind anymore. Listen, and it ensnared his mind. Can I tell you today? Listen, we get a hold of things out in the world. We get a hold of that mess out there. We're looking for something new. And as soon as we see it, that's what we mess up at most of the time, because it will ensnare our mind. Whether it be a young lady, whether it be a young man, whether it be a new home, whether it be a new car, whether it be a new lake lot, whether it be a new mountain house or whatever it is in life, that thing ensnares our mind and we can't get it off of our mind. You young people know coming up in life with the dating and all that, you see that young man, you thought, oh, that's the one right there, and you can't get him off your mind. You young girls grow up and say, oh, we know that's the one right there, and you can't get him off your mind. Listen, all of those things happen in our life. If we're not careful, we will allow the things of the world to ensnare our mind, and we cannot get them off of our mind. It'll take over everything that we do. The people here in Samuel's day, in Israel's day, they wanted it so bad that it had ensnared their mind to the point that no matter what Samuel said here, it didn't make any difference anymore. They still wanted a new king. Also in David's life, talking about that, when those things ensnared his mind, listen to this, it erased all his reasoning. Anybody know of any people right now you can't reason with? Amen. Evidently, you ain't been around much, watched much TV lately, amen. Listen, we got a group of people out there there's no reason with anymore. I don't care how good you can explain the history of America and what's going on and why some of these things are in place. Listen, you couldn't have changed their mind if you wanted to, because, listen, what they have seen and what they want has erased all the reason that they ever had in their mind. You cannot reason with them anymore. Listen, America, our government is trying every way in they can in the world that they can to reason with them and to this reminds me, listen, you don't get mad at me today, parents. Amen. I understand there's kids with problems today, but I understand there's a lot of kids with problems today because you didn't reason with them the right way to begin with. Amen. Reminds me of a child in the house, and the problem we got today is because they got entitlement because mom and dad didn't do their job years ago and beat the soup out of them, and nobody's ever beat them down, and they don't think it's right to be beat down this day and time. They can do anything that they want to do. But listen, they've never had anybody to sit down and reason with them, and now you can't reason with them. And it reminds me of a kid running down that running the house, kicking the walls in, busting the walls in, kicking the doors in, knocking the glasses out, and you just sit back going, well, you know, just let him get his anger out. That little runt come around my house and kick a wall in or kick a door out, they better call the sheriff's department, call 911, because one of us going to need him, amen, because I ain't going back fixing all that junk up because he won't reason with me and nobody's reading. Listen, I ain't going back pick it up. I can take care of him in just a few minutes, and I won't have to worry about the next 3 weeks trying to build a house back. Brother Mike, they can't do that. You want to know why they can't do that this day and time? Because we didn't reason with them before. And around my house, I'm talking about my reasoning. I ain't talking about theirs. Amen? I'm talking about my reasoning. Well, I think they ought to have a voice when they grow up, get old enough, get out of the house, get a job, go to work, pay their own way, they can have a voice. This young group out there protesting, running around. I watched, I don't know if y'all seen that. I don't know who it was. There's an undercover agent from down in Louisiana. Anybody see that post this week? The undercover agent from down in Louisiana. He's standing out there, would look like with an AR-15, standing out there with all his camouflage on and everything on. And he looked at the camera. He said, let me tell you something, you 125-pound punk with your britches hung down to the back of your knees back here. He said, I lift more than you and dumbbells with one arm. He said, I'm calling you out by name, and here's my name, and if you need to know where to find me at, here's where I live at. He said, but I got you on my radar, and I'm going to find you, and I'm going to slam you, and I'm going to lock you up. I eat more than you for breakfast most of the time. He went on, and listen, I loved it that he did that. Why? Because you can't reason with them. And the problem with us as a church today is we got to a point where you can't reason with them anymore. Hey, they got to a point that Samuel couldn't reason with them. No matter what he said, there was no reason. They felt like they were entitled to a new king. They felt like this was theirs, and nobody else was going to tell them anything at all. And listen, we've got a mess in America today, and we've got a mess in the church today because let me say something to y'all up in here. Look right up here. This is New Life Independent Baptist Church. I catch you out there marching in a Black Lives Matter protest with a New Life Baptist Church sign. I'm coming down there real quick just to snatch that sign out of your hand and tell you you're not a part of this church. Hello. You ain't marching for that mess and be up in here. Amen. You may go out there and march if you want to, but you ain't marching for that junk and be up in here and go down. Listen, I seen them out there marching the other day with church signs, holding up church signs in the middle of those. Hey, now listen, there's some weak-kneed preacher that won't go out there and won't say anything because everybody's got them in their pocket, amen, and they can say, we're going to fire you. Hey, fire me, but I'm going to go get the sign first. Amen. I'm going to go out there and protest. Evil. You ain't going to tell me what to do. I might not, but I can tell you what you ain't going to do around here. Amen? Somebody's coming out there. Listen, they wouldn't take any reasoning. We're in a generation that wants no reasoning. We're in a people today that don't want to reason anymore. You can't listen. They don't want to listen to what you got to say. Listen, it ensnared their mind to the point. Listen, there was no reason within them. Listen, and also in David's life, listen, that sin eclipsed everything that God had ever done for him. Everything God ever done for him went out the window. One of David's greatest counselors was by the name of Ahithophel. Matter of fact, he was what's the lady that David looked at? Y'all hit me. Bathsheba, amen. I'd get that in a minute. You think I'd know my Bible by now, amen? But listen, he was Bathsheba's grandfather. He was one of David's greatest counselors. And one of the servants looked at David and said, David, you can't do that. Listen, she's a granddaughter of Ahithophel. And David said, it don't matter who she is. I said, go get her. You couldn't reason with him anymore. And we're messing around in a generation now that you can't reason with anymore. They don't understand reasoning. There's been times when reasoning just went out the window. It eclipsed all that God had ever done. And they said, I don't care. We want a new king. And can I tell you, we're in a place in America right now where they're saying, we want, listen, new world order. Listen, I could stay up here for a while today. We can get in the book of Revelation. We can talk about new world order for a while. Look up here. New world order is going to come. I can promise you it's going to come. You can't stop it because God said it was going to come. Amen? But I can tell you this, you better be prepared to deal with some things along the way when it does come. Amen? You better be prepared to look at some things different in life. But he said here, hey, I don't care what you say. Do what you're going to do. Samuel's trying to tell the people here. And he's trying to warn them here. And God said, hey, you go ahead, go back there, Samuel, and tell them what it's going to do. Listen, in Samuel's day, Samuel had the same thing that we have today. A new generation had emerged. A new generation had to come on the scene with Israel with all new ideas. And all the old ideas had to go. They had to go out the window. They were no good anymore. Even though Samuel, listen to this, was a man that had walked with God. Now listen, I'm a firm believer that change comes. And I'm a firm believer that there's things in life that you and I have to adapt to with change. But I'm a firm believer that we never forget the convicting power of the Word of God and what got us where we are. I don't mind a little change here and there. Matter of fact, I've said this before, since I've been pastoring here at this church in the last 15 years, I compromised a whole lot more in the last 15 years than I did the 15 years before that, Brother Mike. Amen? I mean, there was a time I wasn't going to compromise on nothing. Amen? If I didn't like it, even the Bible didn't have to say it. If I didn't like it, I just didn't like it. Amen? Now I try to find a way to say, okay, can I back this up with Scripture? And if I can go with them with Scripture, then let's guess what? We can go to battle then. Amen? But if I can't back it up with Scripture, I may back off a little bit and pray for a while and pray that God help me through it and God help them through it, and then go back and try to find the right words to do what I need to do. But listen, we do learn to compromise. But listen, I believe in moving forward. I believe in changes. I believe in new challenges. But I believe in doing it without abandoning our old conviction, especially when it comes to the Word of God. Let me just say something to you today, church. If you've got to abandon your conviction from the Word of God, leave it alone. You ain't got no business dealing with it. If you got to give up your convictions in the Word of God and what God says, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. There's 50 commandments in the New Testament alone, amen? Much less the 1,000 in the Old Testament, 680 some. They say it's probably up to 1,000 in the Old Testament. Listen, but just the 50 alone in the New Testament, if you've got to abandon those New Testament commandments, and Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments, leave it alone. You ain't got no business messing with it. Well, Brother Mike, I don't think it'll hurt. Really? You think sin's okay? Amen? Boy, it's getting mighty quiet in here this morning. And I'm just trying to get through an introduction here in just a minute. Amen? But here, they a new generation had come on the scene, and they wanted a change. They had lost their convictions, and Samuel in his lifetime, no doubt, had faced many, many, many difficult and painless times, but he was about to face one of the most difficult times in his life. The elders of Israel presented their request here to Samuel and telling him why they wanted a new king, and I'm sure that it probably broke Samuel's heart. I believe with all my heart that he was a man that felt like, and he did, according to Scripture, that he had done everything according to the will of God, and he had to leave here feeling like a failure. He had served God all his life. From the time God called him there with Eli as a little boy there in the room with Eli, and God had called him and told him he was going to give him the kingdom, and Samuel began to serve God, and now he gets to his old end of days here, and all of a sudden there's his same people that he had preached to and loved on and carried through and done all of these things, and even his sons became corrupt at this time, and now they're saying, Samuel, you're old, your ideas are just outdated, and we want something new. A friend of mine called me, it's been about 6 months ago, And he called me one day and he said, "Bro Mike, can I talk to you?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "I want you to pray for me and I want you to pray for our church." And I said, "Well, what is it?" He said, "Our pastor has gotten up in years." He said, "The pastor's been here for about 40 years. And he said the people have gotten just very discouraged because he's getting older and he repeats himself." And I thought, "My God, I ain't been to church for 15 years and I do that." Amen. And he said, "But he repeats himself a lot and the people are talking and the people want him gone." And see, they're just running around. The sad part is, Brother Ronnie, not one of them had the guts to go to him and tell him. Amen. Hey, the preacher's not some super giant you can't talk to. You know, I'd rather you come tell me you don't like me. Amen. You know my theory on it. I can tell you I don't like you either. That way we're on the same page. You'd probably get mad if I told you that. I'd probably say, "Hey, that's your problem, not mine, if you told me that." Amen. Why? Listen, I just love God regardless, whether you like me or not. I'm glad that God loves me, whether the world likes me or not. Amen. Listen, I'm glad God loves me, whether my wife likes me or not. Amen. And even in the bad times when she says, "I don't like you," that's what God loves me anyway. Amen. But listen, he was dying here of a broken heart, and this gentleman called me and said, "Brother Mike, pray for us." And he said, I don't know what to do. I said, "You pray for your pastor. And you hold him up. He's a man of God. He's given 40 years of his life to that church. He deserves better than that. He deserves to go off the scene in glory. He deserves for y'all to take care of him. Go sit down with him and talk with him. And listen, you may have to face some of those mean-spirited deacons and look them in the eye and say, listen, you ought to get your heart right with God. He's still our pastor until he's not our pastor anymore. At least go sit down and talk with him and tell him, preacher, we want a new king. We want a new pastor. We want somebody." By the way, they say that the fastest growing churches are those that have pastors between the age of 25 and 45. Y'all are out of that range. I'm getting a little nervous. I'll be 60 next year. Amen. I'm trying to keep myself healthy so I can shout. At least somebody come up in here. Yeah, I was preaching a funeral yesterday, Miss Duzanne. Somebody come up in here yesterday with the idea that it's going to be short and quick. Well, it wasn't going to be but a few people here, and just a funeral was going to be short and quick. Boy, were they surprised. Amen. He preached as long as he ever did. Should have known that. Amen. Listen, but Samuel here is brokenhearted. He had obeyed God all his life, and now he's dying with a broken heart. And we find here the word of God. He made his request known unto God, and they were asking for a new king. And here's what they said. "We want to be like other nations." The fact of the matter is, I said earlier, they're forgetting where their strength was. It was in being unlike other nations. Let me tell you why. Let me tell you why the church needs to be the church. Israel was God's covenant people. It was God's chosen people. Amen? And so here's God's chosen people, or we could use that as God's church today, and they're saying, "We don't want a godly king. We want somebody that'll speak for us, but we don't want anybody that'll preach to us." And I was witnessing to a guy. This was, I don't know, back last year, and I needed something to do because Jane and I was, she'll remember this, Jane and I were furniture shopping. I needed something to do. We went furniture shopping all day long. I asked Jane that morning, I said, "You want me to carry the trailer with us so it may rain today?" She said, "No, I don't carry the trailer." I knew that was trouble. I knew we was going to look all day long and not buy nothing. And that's just what happened. "Well, let me lay down on this couch." Okay. "Well, let me lay down on this bed. Well, let me sit in this chair." Amen. All day long. But at afternoon, I was ready to do something. I didn't care if I had to beat Jesus in somebody. Somebody's going to hear me out about the Lord. I happened to go in this furniture store that day, and there's a guy there, and found out he was actually from down in Puerto Rico, Dominican, one of the other. I can't remember. He was a Spanish guy. And I said, "Hey, buddy, He said, where'd your wife go? I said, don't worry about my wife right now. Let's me and you talk. I said, because you ain't going to get nowhere with her. She didn't bring no trailer over here to buy nothing today. She ain't going to spend no money. This is the full store I've been to her with today. Don't waste your time on her today. I got something I need to tell you. It's very important, and it's not about her. You ain't going to get a dollar out of her. You ain't going to get a dime out of her. Amen. Leave her alone. She's going to come back through here in a few minutes. She's going to look at you and go, honey, you ready to go? And we're going to leave. Bottom line. I said, but I can give you the best advice, the best news you ever heard today. I can give you something she can't give you. And I began to go and talk with him about the Lord. And as I began to share the gospel with him, and here's what he told me. He said, I want to go to a church where they don't preach at me. It took me a little while to figure that out, and I guess I understand. Sometimes I don't know if I'm preaching at you or preaching to you or preaching over you or what I'm doing. All I know is I'm just giving you the gospel. Maybe I can ask these young people. Have I preached at y'all? You don't know? Well, I'm glad I ain't the only one that don't know. Yeah. Have I preached to y'all this morning? Yeah. You think it's better I preach to you, right, and not at you? I'm just checking because she don't know. I mean, your hair's dyed blonde. For a reason. I'm just. Kendall. You can answer me later today, Kendall. Kendall, look up here. You love me? Amen. Oh, Lord, help. I thought after last week I was going to have to just give up Facebook for a while anyway. Yeah. Woo, there's some folks didn't like it. Yeah, that's right. The good part, it wasn't the folks in our church. it was those on the outside that didn't like it. Woo, that was, I mean, but I think they're okay. They probably deleted it, so it's fine. You just want to help somebody and you're trying to find a way to do it, Mama? Amen. Listen, they were a people that had given up. Hey, I never did tell you about this young man. He said, I don't want you preaching at me. I don't want people preaching at me. I said, and here's what I told him. I don't do that around my church. I didn't know what he's talking about. I mean, I knew all I did was preach. I don't know. I didn't tell him, but I thought I had to go back and poll the people to see if I preach at them or to them. And now that I just polled them, I can give them the right answer. No, I just preach. I can tell him honestly. I said, I don't do that around my church. I just preach. Amen. He said, well, that's the kind of church I'd like to come to. I said, good, come. Hadn't been in Raleigh, he probably would have. Amen. But listen, they were God's covenant people. My wife is just saying, you just need to preach. That's what I'm trying to do. Amen. It's 12:11. All right. I was trying to get through an introduction here. Israel, let me just give you this. I'll finish it up down the road. It's all Kendall's fault. She messed me up. It cost me 5 minutes. Israel was God's covenant people. And I want you to think about this. God's church, God's people saying, I don't want God. I don't want God. I want something new. Church Samuel goes on to tell us here how dangerous that is. And I'll not get into all that for sake of time, but I'm going to tell you we'd be here for a while. But if you want trouble in your life, let me just, Brother Jeff, come get on the piano for me. If you want trouble in your life, just put God out of it. Make your mind up that you don't want to serve God. Make your mind up that you're not going to reason with authority or anything else that tells you about God. Make your mind up that your sin is so good that that sin has eclipsed everything good that God's ever done in your life. You know what God's going to say? Go ahead. But you just need to be warned. There's a great price to pay for that. Consequences are tough. He said, tell them, Israel. Tell them, Samuel. Their son is going to end up serving that king. You know what happened? You know what's going to happen, friend, if we do that? Our sons will end up serving the world. He said, your daughters will end up being cooks for the king, confectionaries and bakers, and they'll be in the king's harem, and the king will own them. Give up God. I want my own king. I want to do my own thing. The world won't mind having your daughters. I got 4 granddaughters growing up, and I literally stay nervous all the time. I really do. I stay nervous all the time. I don't know what's going to happen down the road. I stay nervous with them going to school and being out anywhere at all in the world. I told their daddy the other day, and me and him sat down and talked to me about going to Durham. And I said, man, don't go there. Don't take them out over there. Don't take them to places like that. Why? Because right today they'll get drugged out of the car and beat to death for no reason at all. Somebody else will take them. Grandson's the same way. He said, try it, they'll take your fields. He said, go ahead and try it, they'll take the tent. You know what he was referring to right there? Listen, you might ought to think about this. The world's already sopped us up a lot of times in some ways, but the things of the world sure has sopped us up in our tenth to God also a lot of times. We can't afford to give to God anymore. Why? We're just spending the world. We got too many things to pay for in the world. He said, but if they decide to do that, let them go ahead. But there's going to be a day that they'll cry out. And I'll not hear. And what a sad testimony. What a sad time in the church. If we ever get to the place, church, where our God will not hear our cry. Brother Gene, sometimes I stay awake at night and wake up in the middle of the night crying and begging God, praying in the middle of the night and saying, God, I need your help. Did I do something wrong today? And before I get out of the bed this morning, God, I may break fellowship with you if I'm not careful, and I can't afford that. Let me tell you why I can't afford it. Here's why I can't afford it. Right here and right there 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 and right there. Because, Brother Ronnie, when I get out of the bed in the morning and I start praying, my kids are most time at the top of my prayer list. And the very thought, Brother Mike, that I couldn't pray for my kids and it wouldn't get through. And one of them got harmed that day because I couldn't get a prayer through to God would kill me down inside. We can't afford a new king. What was you going to preach on today? Michael, title this right here, Price of a New King. The price of a new king. There's a price to pay for a new king. There's going to be a price to pay for this new world order. It's coming, by the way. It's coming. Amen. The question is, are you prepared for it? Are you prepared for it? Young people, listen to me. You need to make your mind up now whether you're going to serve God or whether you're still looking for something new out in the world. Amen? The price of a new king don't come cheap. It's very expensive. Sometimes we could lose the ear of God just because of it. Let's all stand on our feet today. Every head bowed, every eye closed. For just a few minutes today.